dog ass of Tenacious D. You're listening to Without Your Head.
Welcome to the station of decapitation without your head. I'm Nasty Neil.
And this is Annabelle Lecter.
Mm-hmm. And we are joined by the artist of the month here, Darren Beck. How are you doing?
I'm doing just fine. Glad to be here.
Excellent, excellent. We are happy to have you here.
Great.
Now, you just came back. You were on the road.
That was for work, not for music.
Oh, well, forget all that.
When I'm not doing music, I'm an interior decorator, so
really?
That keeps me busy otherwise.
That's interesting, though. Is there any similarities between the two art forms of interior decoration and music?
Aside from the fact that there's times when I don't want to do either of them, no. No, there's nothing at all. No, my interior decorating job, it's pretty corporate as far as what I do. I don't have any sort of artistic input in it at all. So I'm basically a glorified handyman. So
maybe we should just restart the interview. No,
that's okay.
All right. Excellent. But you did tour not that long ago with Goblin.
Yes, and it was about one of the most amazing times I've ever had in my life, musical or otherwise. That's one of my favorite bands of all time, and yeah, that was just an amazing, amazing experience.
Now, how did that come about?
I don't really know, other than the fact that Goblin's management reached out to us, and I believe that they had heard us, you know, prior to going on tour with them, and we're one of the few bands that has similarities to Goblin that's active in around America, and so they just hit us up. And I think a lot of it had to do with it. A lot of the reviews we get on our albums, we get compared to Goblin quite often.
Mm-hmm. Now, for everybody, when you say we, you mean Pinkish Black?
Pinkish Black, yes.
Mm-hmm. Now, that has to make you pretty proud when someone would compare you in any way to Goblin, and then for them to seek you guys out.
Yeah, I can pretty much die a happy man after that. I've been listening to Goblin since my mom bought me Dawn of the Dead on VHS in like 85 or 86, and just, you know, have loved that music ever since. And I'm a big fan of Suspiria. I love the soundtrack to Patrick. I love just tons of their stuff. The Roller is one of the best albums ever, and they're a great band, soundtrack, music, and otherwise, you know. So, and super nice guys. It was 4 out of 5 of the original members on tour, and then one of the, I don't know if you've ever heard of Zombie before, but if you like Goblin, you'll love Zombie. One of the members of Zombie was on tour with Goblin, and it was just an incredible experience.
Mm-hmm. Now, you know, sometimes, you know, if you open for like an established band, maybe some of the crowd will not respond to you favorably. How was the crowd reaction?
Better than usual, honestly, because we've been associated with heavy metal for whatever reason, and we end up getting put on a lot of metal bills, and metal people don't know what to think when two people walk out on a stage without any guitars. We're pretty good at winning an audience over, but the Goblin audience was a lot better reaction than usual, just because I think those people are a lot more open-minded musically than your average metal audience.
Yeah.
Well, does that open the doors for you to go into different kinds of venues? Is it, now that you've been to these different places, do you feel like you have more opportunities?
I think there's a lot more people that are paying attention to what we're doing now to tour with Goblin is not something that just every band gets to do, you know, even though a lot of bands would probably love to, regardless of whether they sound like them or not. But I think a lot more people are taking an interest in us as far as like sort of the progressive rock crowds or stuff like that, or the weirder music, less metal type stuff. And that's all fine for me, because I don't know the first thing about heavy metal, really. I've never really been a big follower of heavy metal, so...
You said they were nice guys. Did they give you any advice or give you any input on what they thought of your performance?
Yeah, they had all sorts of things to say, but I think the best compliment came from Fabio, the bass player. He said on the first night we played with them, he came out and he said, "You sound old like us," and that's pretty awesome, you know.
Yeah, so you've been doing what you've been doing for a long time, and you're comfortable with yourself.
Right, right, and he, yeah, they, you know, it was just really crazy to see them standing on the side of the stage some nights just listening, you know, and it's just, I don't know, never thought anything like that would ever happen, but but it did, and I'm glad.
You said you knew
it. Something is that it would be one thing, I mean, there's a lot of bands that sound like they're a copy of another band, and I would assume that those bands that are being copied would not appreciate that. So for them to enjoy your sound and not feel like you're just a copycat, that's huge.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, yeah, we have similarities just because of all the keyboards and sort of the long, expansive songs and strange time signatures and stuff. But I mean, we're in no means a Goblin ripoff band by any means. I mean, they don't have vocals on most of their stuff. And, you know, obviously we do. And, you know, yeah, it's definitely different than Goblin, but you can definitely see how it harkens back to the whole horror soundtrack kind of stuff.
Yeah. You said, you know, obviously not heavy metal, but sometimes you guys get booked with them or put on. What kind of genre do you consider Pinkish Black?
Really, I don't know. Because it's all such a conglomeration of and an amalgam of all sorts of just different stuff, you know, because I listen to a lot of 70s soft rock and stuff like that, and a lot of like Nina Simone and my drummer's, you know, been a big metal fan for years, and he, I mean, we both like a lot of progressive rock. Really, the main band that we listen to, or the main two bands that we listen to that we can actually see eye to eye on, aside from Goblin, is Steely Dan and Magma. And it's just, I don't know, we, the two of us working together, me and John, my drummer, it creates something pretty different, just because we're coming from such different places. And but I would say if I had to make it a genre, I guess it would be like, I don't know. It's just really heavy. I don't, that's the way to look at it.
Yeah.
It's like heavy soft rock.
So you have a background in fairly mainstream music, it sounds like. So before you pursued this style, what were you doing as a musician?
Oh, I was doing all sorts of things. I mean, I've been in, I guess got my like foothold playing live as a teenager back in the early 90s with a band called Thorazine Dreams, and we were kind of like a Butthole Surfers type psychedelic band. And from there, I did some like, you know, shoegaze stuff in the 90s, and, you know, back then we called it space rock. It wasn't shoegaze because we were all listening to Noi and Faust and early Pink Floyd and stuff, and that's all just kind of harkening back to that. But really, when I started playing with John, my drummer, my current drummer, and our previous bass player in a band called The Great Tyrant, our music got a lot heavier and louder because those two guys had been in a band called Yeti, that's kind of a legendary prog band, and their music was a lot heavier than anything I'd ever done, and I kind of had to retrain myself how to play because I'd never done anything that heavy. And
how do you hold into that?
What's that?
You're making it sound like it sounds like such a different thing than you had been doing. How did you end up meeting these people and wanting to do that sound?
Well, Texas is kind of a, you know, very small. Well, it's big, but it's very small as far as like, you know, we're in the Bible Belt here, so we're surrounded by a bunch of rednecks, and it's pretty easy to find who the cool people are around you because there's so many uncool ones. But over the years, like we when I was in my band prior to this, Pointy Shoe Factory, and those guys were in Yeti, you know, we were both doing weird type of music, and even though we didn't sound a lot like each other, we would end up on bills all the time together, because it was just like, who else do you put together? You know, it's just weird, so let's just put these weird bands on this bill. And so through that, you know, my band broke up, Pointy Shoe Factory broke up, and Yeti lost one of its core members to death. And so once they broke up, I approached John and Tommy from Yeti and had them start playing with me, and that's pretty much how that goes. But yeah, we're all from Fort Worth, and you know, it's like I said, it's kind of big place, but a small town.
Did you find like a chemistry right away when you started playing music together?
Not at all. No, it took weeks and weeks and or months of just like getting drunk at practice and trying to just, we had to become friends first before we could really, you know, and become close just on a personal level before I think anything really clicked. And it took a long time, but by the time we recorded our first album, I think that everything had kind of fallen into place. And right before we ended, I think we were right on the cusp of doing something pretty amazing.
No,
well, it's pretty interesting because from what I've heard, most bands get together because they know each other and they're already friendly. So was it just that you could see each other's talent and were so interested in the other's style of music making that that kind of fascination brought you together?
Exactly. We were acquaintances. You know, we knew each other. We had never really hung out that much. But no, it was definitely a thing of like, I know these guys are going to get it. They know I'm, you know, and they knew that I was going to get it as far as just being able to, you know, open up musically and do something different, you know, than just like typical 4/4, 3-chord kind of stuff, you know?
Yeah.
So it was, yeah, it was much like, yeah, you described it perfectly.
You mentioned, you know, there's, not necessarily a lot of cool people in Texas. So what kind of venues do you guys play?
Oh, I mean, there's actually right now it's pretty a pretty lush landscape for music in the North Texas area. I mean, there's several venues around here to play in Fort Worth. We play Lola's, and in Dallas we play Trees or Three Links or Club Dada and Denton just north of here. That's part of the Golden Triangle that we call it. You know, Denton, Dallas, and Fort Worth. There's a club that's been there called Rubber Gloves Rehearsal Studios. It's been there for, I think, 15 years now. And I've been playing there since I was, you know, a kid. And, yeah, so, I mean, we get out and then we go to Austin and we go to San Antonio and Oklahoma and places like that, just kind of regionally.
So
do you feel like where you are that the music scene is growing? Because in New England, there's a lot of old venues that are just being turned into condos. It's difficult. It's stuff's getting pushed down. And
right.
In your area, do you feel like it's growing?
Yeah, it definitely is. I mean, right now, along with as many clubs as we have, there's a lot of good bands in town right now, which, you know, back in the 90s, that wasn't really the case. That's why, you know, bands like 22 Factory and Yeti would end up getting on the same bills together just because there wasn't a whole lot of bands. But no, there's a ton of bands right now. There's a band called Terminator 2 that's awesome, a band called Blooded Head that's awesome, Vulgar Fashion, Deaf Rain, Unconscious Collective. I mean, there's just a ton of stuff around here right now.
You mentioned Pointy Shoe Factory, and you had some of the tracks on Dragon Ball Z. How did that come about?
Well, unbeknownst to a lot of people, I guess they Dragon Ball Z, the American version, was actually produced out of Fort Worth. And I had some friends that worked at the company there, and they were playing our CD around the offices, and it ended up getting put on the soundtrack. And, I get hit up on Facebook and stuff all the time by Dragon Ball Z kids that are wanting that the music off that soundtrack because it's apparently not released anywhere. But it's pretty weird.
That's very cool though. Are you a Dragon Ball Z fan?
No, I hate it.
Yay.
No,
I'm not either. My brother is a big fan.
For a bit there I was trying to do some additional soundtrack work after that for GT. And Dragon Ball GT, and I had to watch the first two episodes just so many times in a row. It was like I had never watched it before, so I was just like, "What is this?" It's like, this is not Fat Albert, you know? Yeah, I was like, I was born in '76, so it's like, yeah, this is not animation, you know? This is like, I'm used to Fat Albert and, you know, HR Puff and stuff and shit. I'm not that was not for me.
What month in 76?
June 19th.
Okay, all right. So I'm a little bit
older
than you.
Yeah, now you're a couple months older than me.
Yeah, so I'm an old man here in the show.
Old man.
But if my brother was here, he's actually a huge fan of Dragon Ball Z.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, Troy. Jeez. Troy loves Dragon Ball Z.
Said that out loud. That's embarrassing.
Oh man, there's fans all over for that stuff, and I guess maybe if I watched it from the beginning and I like it, I don't know, but I'm not gonna try.
Yeah. Now, for Pinkish Black, do you have any specific tracks that mean the most to you?
Yeah, I would say Ashtray Eyes. I really like that song a lot. It just is, I don't know, it just kind of, I can kind of sink into that one. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, there's a lot of them. Loss of Feeling of Loss is another one. Bodies in Tow, I guess, is probably the one that I have the most affinity for, just because I think we've been playing that one the longest, and when we wrote that one, we kind of knew that we were on to something different than what we had been doing in Great Tyrant, and because it was much more poppy sounding, for lack of a better word. You know, it had rhythm and melody, and it wasn't too extreme, and it didn't get, you know, I mean, you know, it's something, I'm not saying my mom could listen to it or anything, but at the same time, it was way less extreme than what we had been doing in Great Tyrant, and I felt like that was kind of a branching off point. Mm-hmm. And showed us that we could do something that we weren't able to do in Great Tyrant.
Ashtray Eyes was actually the first track I listened to you, listened of yours, and I thought it was great as well.
Thanks.
You're very welcome. It came about oddly enough, because we were talking on Facebook, and we were gonna go see Goblin, and but it was canceled, and you had mentioned that you were touring with them, and so I started listening to stuff, and so it was just kind of interesting.
No, that Goblin that canceled was actually the other Goblin.
Right.
It's like a four top situation where there's like each top has his own group or whatever, but no, that's Claudio Simonetti's Goblin, and I've heard good things about him, but yeah, it's. Yeah, the version I went with was the preferable one for me, because it's four original members as opposed to one, so, you know.
Do they war at all? Is there, like, a rivalry?
No, I don't think so. I think that maybe they're not so stoked that he's running around saying it's Goblin, you know, but he does say it's Claudio Simonetti's Goblin, so, you know, I mean, what do you do, you know?
Yeah.
He was a crucial part of that band, but so were all the other members. So, you know, and I don't know. I've always been of the thought, once a band breaks up, if the band doesn't have all the original members, you don't keep that name. But at the same time, I've never been in a band as legendary as Goblin. So I don't know that my opinions would hold up.
Mm-hmm. Pink Floyd, Roger Waters.
Right, right.
What was that?
Nothing. Go ahead.
Oh, okay. Well, I did want to bring up American Idol.
yeah, it was kind of strange. Have you seen the video?
I did see the video, and actually, I had showed my mom. I said, "This, you know, who our Artist of the Month is here," and she totally remembered your episode.
That's hilarious. That's really funny. No, that was. I'll go kind of shoot interview on you here. And, that was my successful attempt at detoxing from methamphetamine. To go on American Idol. And no, you can kind of tell that I'm not so comfortable if you look at, well, I mean, for other reasons besides the meth, you know, withdrawal. But no, it was just kind of something I needed to get out of town for a while, and it was like, okay, well, American Idol's going on in New Orleans, so I took a Greyhound to New Orleans and didn't know that Gene Simmons was going to be the guest judge, but saw him walking through and asked one of the cameramen, or told one of the cameramen that guy looks like Gene Simmons, and they were like, that is Gene Simmons, and like, what's he doing here? And they were like, he's the guest judge today, and I was like, oh, neat. But yeah, and I told him Phantom of the Park was one of my favorite movies ever, and he did not seem to be happy about that. So.
He doesn't seem to be happy about a lot of things, though.
Screw that guy. He was nice to me, at least. You know, he had some, like, I wouldn't say constructive criticisms, but none of them were particularly rude to me. I mean, you know, and I don't know. It was, it was like going to a psychotic church camp or something. That's the only thing I can relate it to, because, you know, I was 28 at the time, and I was surrounded by a bunch of 16-year-olds that were, like, crying, you know, and this was, like, their only, this was the first time they'd ever done music, and probably the last time, and yeah. For me, this was just, like, kind of taking a piss, but at the same time, it was, you know, I didn't think I was going to end up on TV. The last thing I wanted to do is hot Coke or Chevy or anything like that with my music, yeah. So... it was, I just wanted to get on TV. It was total Andy Kaufman, Tony Clifton style thing, you know. So, no, I was not expecting to be American Idol. I wanted to be the best of the worst, basically.
Yeah.
But no, I spent two days, or I guess I was there for about 3 or 4 days, actually, in New Orleans doing that whole process, and kicked the meth and just drank a bunch of wine, and I ended up watching Princess Bride at 4 in the morning the night before my... or the morning before my audition, and drinking 2 bottles of wine before my audition. So I was in rare form.
Andre the Giant would be very proud.
I think so.
Yeah. Now, how long was the actual like tryout when you're in front of the judges? Is it?
It's not quick. I was there for about 4 days, because the first day you get a wristband and a number. Then the next day you go sing. We sang on what is that in New Orleans there, the Superdome?
Yeah.
We sang at in front of like some no name judges in front of the Superdome, and I could tell it was like some hip hop people or whatever that were, they were, you know, they obviously were like hip hop producers or whatever that were listening to me sing for the first time, and they basically said, "We don't know what you're doing, but you obviously do, so we're going to go ahead and let you go through." So then you have to sing the next day in front of the executive producers. And then the next day they did interviews with me in my hotel room and all this, had me like pretend like I was working in a record store, and then had me pretend like I was coming off the Greyhound and film all this stuff. And they didn't use any of it. So, you know, I guess they were going to make me into like, they were going to do some expose of me being a weirdo or something, but I just wasn't weird enough or like not weird in the way that they wanted me to be, you know, I'm not retarded. Like, so I don't know,
but they just actually like create like a background for you in this story. Huh?
Pretty well. I mean, I was at the time working in a record store in Fort Worth, but you know, but they tried to make it look like they were at my record store filming me. Yeah, so it's all, you know, typical reality show stuff, you know.
Uh-huh. I can't imagine them doing that process for everybody. So there's no way that a lot of those people... Oh, do you think there's any way that you stood out as a character that they want to pursue that?
Oh, yeah, no. I mean, you could just see in the line of people lined up to go try out, I was definitely, like, the black sheep out of that whole thing, and... No, it was like me and 2 other people that they did that whole thing for, like all the interviews and extra footage and stuff. But I guess I just wasn't crazy enough. I don't know.
Well, my mom remembered it very funny, so.
No, it was pretty, I mean, I'm glad I did it. You know, I mean, it was like just one more weird thing I've done, you know, in life. And I think that's just another story to tell. So, you know.
Yeah.
But at the same time, you know, I did go there to kind of get off the meth, so, and that did work. So I haven't done that stuff since I was 28. So
okay. I was going to ask,
that's awesome. I've known people personally that have, you know, so congratulations on that. That's huge.
Well, when you do it in front of a national television audience, you know, it's kind of, it definitely puts the spotlight on it and makes it to where it's like, okay, I'm completely distracted by other things now besides my own stupid addictions. So, you know.
And I hope without your head doesn't bring you back.
No, I don't think so. Sticking with the smokables and drinkables, so.
All right. Nice. how did Pink, where is it like the origin of the name Pinkish Black?
Our old bass player Tommy from the Great Tyrant had misquoted Burroughs. I can't tell you what book it came out of. But it was a misquote from Burroughs. The actual words were Blackish Pink, which is actually the name of our side project that is just kind of like an improv noise band. But no, there's been talk on when our first press release came out, there was talk about how the name was derived from the color that the blood was when we found Tommy after his suicide on the carpet, because the carpet was stained pinkish black, and that was said in our practice room, but that's by no means where we came up with the name. And yeah, I'd like to clarify that. It's not as gory as it sound, or as it was made out to be, and it was something that we had prior to Tommy committing suicide. But but yeah, that got kind of misconstrued when our first press release came out.
Mm-hmm. It sounds like you have had a lot of true pain and these experiences in your life. How do you feel that affects you as a band?
Pretty heavily. Because like I said, when John and Tommy were in Yeti, they lost Doug Ferguson, the keyboard player, due to the wrong kind of prescription medication. And he went into a coma and never came out. And then, you know, like I said, Tommy committed suicide, our bass player, which is why we're a two-piece, because there's just no... We couldn't think of anyone else that would fit in with us as well and had been around as long and just doing the same kind of stuff that we'd been doing. So we just never even tried to add another member. And then shortly after that, my sister died of an overdose. And then right after that, my dad killed himself. And that was last year. And no, it almost broke us up. And then after that, we wrecked our tour van. And that was kind of the final straw. And we took several month hiatus just so I could just kind of stay on the couch and go to the therapist. And mm-hmm. I went through a lot of therapy as a teenager, and never as an adult, I think I would ever willingly go to a therapist. But there just comes some times in your life where you can't drink the problem away anymore. So I got mm-hmm. to that point. And but now everything's good now. So, oh, it's not good, but, you know, everything's fine now.
How do you feel music has helped you manage all of that?
You have to have an outlet, you know. I feel like a lot of people in this world, work is their outlet, or television's their outlet, or drugs and alcohol are their outlet. Music is my outlet. It's what I put everything into. If I'm, you know, I don't write a lot of biographical songs or anything, you know. I don't write, like, I don't really put all my problems into the music, but at the same time, you know, just to get relentless on my keyboard is better than to get relentless on my girlfriend or something like that, you know. Mm-hmm. I'd rather take it out on a microphone in an audience than I would like another individual, you know. And I kind of look at when I play a show as people are paying to come watch my therapy session, you know.
Yeah.
But you know, I'm glad it's there. If it hadn't have been there, I don't know that I would even be here now, because I was pretty emotionally traumatic as a teenager. And yeah, music has always been the one thing I was like, nobody can take this away from me, you know. So that's a good thing to have, you know.
Oh. It's interesting that you mentioned using your experiences doing shows as your therapy session, but in the same vein, it seems that would be how your audience would connect to you anyways, because it would be the same for them, that whatever you're putting out there is also giving them that same similar experience. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. And I think you're right about that. I mean, I don't truly believe that anyone is just 100% happy. And I'm sure anybody that willingly comes to one of my shows is probably going to find something at least musically that they can like grasp onto, you know. I mean, I mumble a lot when I sing, and my vocals are all completely covered up with reverb. So the chances of you figuring out what I'm saying live or on record are pretty, you know, it's going to take you some work. But, you know, I think that at least people can feel what kind of emotion I'm trying to attain, like through music, you know, when they're hearing it. And, they maybe can, you know, can feel me through that. I don't know. It's, but yeah, I mean, it's weird to say, but I don't think that people really come to our show expecting to have a good time. It's more about the music than about like a party, you know? So it's, cause I don't even talk, like when we play live, I don't talk in between the songs. I'm never like, how y'all doing tonight? You know, or I'm never like, there's no stage banner, you know, it's just, I'll leave that to somebody else. You know, I just, in between the songs, I drink and smoke and, wait for the next song.
It sounds almost like if you go to see paintings, you're not going, you're not obviously having a conversation with the artist there. You're going to appreciate the feelings you get from seeing that painting.
Right, right. And I'm not here to like impose myself on you. I'm here to like let you take it for what it is, you know. I'm not going to force, like the one thing I hate the most is when I see bands that will tell people to move closer to the stage, or, you know, why isn't anybody dancing? You know, it's like, well, maybe they don't feel like it, you know, and just let them take it for what it is. Let them take it for what they want it as, you know.
Mm-hmm. I was just going to compare quickly to a lot of movies that both of us like. And some people ask, well, why would you like a movie that doesn't make you feel good or isn't uplifting? And it's like, well, not everything has to be. I mean, if it makes you feel something, to me, is that is something.
Right. Yeah, I mean, you think Maniac makes me feel good? No.
Right,
you know,
right.
But I've seen it several times. The Wrestler doesn't make me feel very good, but I've watched that a bunch.
Yeah, Salo or a Serbian film. It's not like I'm standing up and cheering them along. It's just it's an interesting movie.
What? Newborn porn?
Well, that scene does get me pretty sick.
I'm standing, clapping. Woo!
Yeah, yes, right.
Get that baby.
Yeah, which is currently a big debate over on our YouTube page about the newborn porn
right.
scene.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Very interesting. But along those lines, what kind of movies are you into?
Oh, man, all sorts of stuff. I mean, it's too broad. I mean, really.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
I mean, as of late, like, I've just been watching a bunch of YouTube stuff and tracking down old local commercial ads from the 70s and 80s from, mm-hmm. you know, I mean, that's... I've watched a lot of that, and I've watched a lot of The Office lately, and that's, other than that, we're going to watch Raw later tonight, because I haven't seen it yet this week, and...
I won't give any spoilers.
Yeah. Okay, please don't.
All right.
No, I watch a lot of wrestling stuff, and that's actually how I found out about you, Neil, was because, through In Your Head, you know, and... but yeah, cause I actually think my first time I heard that was, because you interviewed Sean Oliver. It was your first interview with him. And I told you I'd done the You Shoot soundtrack or the You Shoot music.
Cool.
And, yeah, so that I love their product for sure. I watch a lot of, the Kayfabe commentary stuff all the time.
Yeah.
But,
Sean Oliver,
but yeah,
good
I
friend
mean,
of the show. He's actually, Sean Oliver's actually been on In Your Head more than any other guest.
Yeah, I know that. It's like, what, 5 times now, I think?
Yeah. Very cool guy. And not just because he sends me free DVDs to watch, but definitely the best of... there's a lot of crappy shoot interviews out there, but his is by far the best quality.
Yeah, I know. I'm just waiting for him to get Kevin Von Erich while he's still alive. So.
Yeah. Until I start putting out shoot tapes. And it's totally different.
What's that?
Until I start putting out my own shoot interviews and...
Oh, well, there you go.
Yeah.
No, but I mean, yeah, I watch all sorts of stuff. I watch a lot of, like, I kind of have things segmented. It sounds weird, but, like, I'll get up and watch Saved by the Bell in the mornings, and then I watch, like, Roseanne on Tuesdays and Wonder Years on Wednesdays and Cosby Show on Thursdays. And then Friday nights, I usually watch horror movies, and Saturday nights, I watch a lot of Saturday Night Live reruns. Sunday mornings, I watch Davey and Goliath and CBS Sunday Morning, and my television is kind of regimented to what I used to watch when I was a kid.
Yeah,
and I'm just glad that my girlfriend can tolerate that, because it's my prior roommates did not. So.
You need two of my favorite sitcoms, and since you were actually born the same year as me, did you grow up also watching The Wonder Years when it was on originally? Because, you know, I grew up watching it. And I was the same age as Arnold when it
yep.
first started. So,
yep. No, and it was weird how the things, like, you know, were it coincided with what I was going through a lot of times when I was watching it when it was in first run. You know?
Even though it's different, it's still, you know, similar themes and, you know, a different decade, but still similar themes that anyone goes through, I would think.
No, yeah, it's very, very relatable, and no, I totally remember that every time I watch episodes, and there's just a certain, it's like, I'm very into, like, mashed potato viewing, you know, just comfort food kind of television watching, and I don't follow a whole lot. I still need to watch last season of Walking Dead, and, you know, there's just a lot of shows that everybody's like, oh, you don't watch that, and I'm just like, too busy watching Cosby Show.
It is fun nowadays with on-demand, Netflix, like, and even be able to get cheap DVDs, so you can watch, like, whole seasons or the whole run of an entire series of a television show at once.
Yeah, and it's what I wished we had when I was a kid, you know, and I remember when VCRs came out and just being amazed with that, you know, and just being like, wow, I can actually watch this again, you know,
yeah.
Or watch it later.
Yeah, I remember when they would have, like, even a miniseries. I remember, like, the Roots miniseries, and it was, like, this, it was, like, 12, like, VHS tapes. I'm putting my hands across the screen, even though no one can see me. But, you know, it's this big block of VHS. Now you get it, and it's, like, one disc.
Mm-hmm, yeah. No, I towed it. I mean, I still towed around. I probably have a collection of about 300 VHS tapes that I still towed around that I just can't. You know, I've moved with them since I was a teenager, and I can't seem to part with them.
I have tons of wrestling VHS tapes that I used to record everything I would watch, any kind of wrestling, and I haven't watched them in years, but I still have them. I always think of someday putting them over to DVD, but
right. Mm-hmm. I'm sure
a lot of stuff, and it's almost like they're your traveling buddies. They've been there with you through your life,
right. No, I mean, the one, I'm sitting here looking at this one right now that's sitting on my entertainment center, and it's a VHS of The Christmas Story that I taped off of TV in, like, 86 or 87, and it's got all the commercials and stuff still, like, intact, and, every year on Christmas night, I have to watch that specific VHS tape.
Yeah.
Because it's the same one I've been watching.
At the time, you probably wished you edited all that out.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. Now it's like, I cherish it when I can find, like, any kind of, like, local advertising or, you know, the old Fox 33, like, logos and stuff, just, like, any of that stuff. It just, like, makes me feel like I'm, you know, 9 years old sitting in my bedroom again, so.
Mm-hmm. I don't want to talk a lot about wrestling, but. Since I have someone here I think is intelligent and likes wrestling, what is it about wrestling that you enjoy?
Well, I'll tell you, it kind of harkens back to the nostalgic thing because when I, you know, Fort Worth, I grew up watching the Von Erichs and, you know, all the world-class championship wrestling stuff. And when that went out of like being good, you know, about the time that I started playing music. And then I was online one day searching. And so that would have been, I started playing when I was 10. So that was 86. And by that point, let's see, in world class, you had most of Von Erichs were already dead by that point. And you had like, with Eric Embry was their world champ. So, I mean, not anything you really want to watch. So I started playing music, and then for, you know, two decades, I didn't even think about wrestling. And I was looking on Amazon for Texas punk stuff because I'm a big fan of old Texas punk stuff, like Stickmen with Ray Guns and Big Boys and, you know, just random stuff like that. It was like, you may also like, and it had that Triumph and Tragedy, or no, it was the Heroes of World Class documentary.
The one that's not made by WWE?
Right, and man, that is a hell of a documentary. When I ordered it, because I hadn't thought about the Von Erichs in years, and I was like, oh yeah, I used to watch Von Erichs, and so I ordered it, and I was probably 26 then, or no, I was like 34 then, I guess. And this is actually, I was probably about 30 then. And yeah, when I saw it, it just immediately sucked me back into being like a kid, like I had totally forgotten about like Missing Link and Kamala and Skandar Akbar and all these people. And but like as soon as I saw him, I knew exactly who it was, and it was just like, wow, I haven't thought about this in forever. So it's like, you know, it's like discovering a cartoon that you had forgotten you liked when you were a kid, but used to watch all the time.
Yeah.
And that's what got me back into it. And I had never followed current wrestling. And I'm glad I started following it when I did, because actually it's kind of good now. You know, I love Bray Wyatt. I love the Wyatt family, and I love all the guys that were in the Shield. And, you know, it's actually a good time to be a wrestling fan.
Yeah, there's actually some, there was for the last 10 years is pretty poor, but there's actually some good stuff popping up.
Yeah, exactly. I never even bothered in the 90s or early 2000s, because I used to be a manager at Hot Topic in my late 20s, and you know, we would get all the WCW shit, you know, so I would see Sting and all this crap all the time, and I just couldn't, you know, it's like I just looked at that as a nuisance, because I just had to fold all those shirts. So yeah, it was nothing I was interested in checking out.
Just real quick about that Von Erich documentary. The end of that, when it's they're just talking to Kevin, and he's like, you know, I used to be one of like, I don't know, six brothers, and now I'm an only brother.
Now I'm not even a brother. Yeah.
And then so he talks about his dad, and his dad told him, you're weak because all his other brothers killed themselves. And he's just like, you're weak because, you know, you couldn't do it like the other ones could, like, because he couldn't kill himself.
Yeah.
And it's like, wow, that's like horrible that someone's father would tell him that.
That's some harsh stuff there. And I've watched that documentary. God, I don't even know how many times I've shown it to like every one of my friends that grew up in Fort Worth, just because I knew that as soon as they saw it, they would recognize everything. But that's some harsh stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Terrible, tragic story, and I can't believe that more documentaries haven't been made about that. And I can't believe that no one's made a Bruiser Brody documentary yet. I mean, come on, that's a story, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that stabbed, and that wrestler to this day is still like a major heel in Puerto Rico, and like They played up a real murder as part of like a wrestling angle where
it made a bigger
draw to people, because like, oh, this is the guy that killed Bruiser Brody. I mean, that's insane.
Yeah, it was, and he ended up being a politician down there. And yeah, I mean, I'm sitting here right now wearing a Bruiser Brody T-shirt, so that story needs to be made into a documentary.
Yeah.
Or I've read the book Brody, but you know that needs to be turned into a movie.
Definitely. Now, when did you get into actually creating music?
I started playing when I was 10. I heard the song "The Chain" by Fleetwood Mac, and for whatever reason, I decided I needed to learn how to play that song. And so I got a classical acoustic guitar. I took two or three guitar lessons, and the guy basically taught me how to hold the thing properly and how to tune it. And then about 6 months later, my mom took me to the mall, and I bought a Fleetwood Mac tablature book and learned how to play a bunch of Fleetwood Mac songs, as they were like my first favorite band. And I basically just changed around a bunch of chords on Fleetwood Mac songs and started writing my own songs, and I'm kind of still doing the same thing now. So
So
it's been I've been playing music now for 28 years.
How many different instruments do you play?
Guitar, bass, drums. I've just learned, my girlfriend just taught me saxophone, and keyboards and vocals. And I've attempted violin a few times, and I still haven't gotten that one. But pretty much just the rock instruments.
Mm-hmm. Now, how long did you say she just taught you the saxophone? Like, how long that did that take you to learn?
Basically, just, you know, she just taught me. I don't know. It went pretty quick. It was like an afternoon, or like an hour.
Yeah. I can't even play the kazoo.
That's not what you need to be doing. You need to be doing this.
Oh, okay. All right, all right.
I'll play the kazoo.
There we go. That'll be a happy man.
But no, it's I've wanted to play saxophone forever, and I've tried before, and she may just be a really good teacher, because she just sat me down and showed me what to do and gave me a couple suggestions, showed me the right place to put my fingers, and I just kind of started going, and now I'm trying to figure out how to incorporate that into Pinkish Black's music, but, you know, I don't know. We'll see.
That's cool, though.
So your girlfriend is also a musician?
Yeah, she's played saxophone in a few bands, and she's also a DJ around here. It goes by the name of DJ Wild in the Streets. And she spins a lot of, like, French pop and old soul music and stuff like that.
I'm sorry. Before I forget, because you brought it up briefly earlier, was the movie Maniac. And I assume you mean the original Maniac?
Yes.
And I don't know, have you seen the remake?
I haven't, no. It has the guy from Lord of the Rings in it, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Is it good?
It is.
It's very good.
Really? Okay.
Good. Yeah.
Did y'all do a dinner at a movie?
We did horror and remakes. We're kind of anti-remake for the most part. It was really good.
Did y'all do a dinner and a movie on that one?
We filmed one.
We have a lot of dinner and movies that are kind of in the cutting room floor, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
But we liked it. It's very good.
That's cool.
It's made differently because obviously his physicality is completely different, but it's still is creepy, and he does a really good job.
I think you should see it, because I don't know why, but I think you would enjoy it. But
well, on y'all's suggestion, I'll definitely check it out for sure.
Yeah, and just like Annabelle said, it's completely different, obviously, since it's like if that actor would have tried to play the maniac like was played in the original one, it would have been like just a failure, I think. But you know, they incorporated his different look and abilities into the new Maniac, but kept the story similar. So it's interesting.
Right.
It's good.
You gotta get access and let us know what you think too.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, I will definitely. I really like what Tom Savini said once he saw the final cut of Maniac, and you know, he was just doing the effects on the movie, and he was like, you know, I didn't really know what movie we were making, and once I saw it, I wasn't happy. And
really?
Yeah, it's like, yeah, I don't think he saw a script. I think it was just like, here's your effects, do this. And he wasn't happy with it. I know that.
Well,
why did he not like it?
I'm not sure. I can't even remember. It was an interview that I'd heard with him. Yeah, absolutely. But that movie is like, that movie almost seems real, you know? I mean, the way the main character portrays it, you know, it's just, I mean, it's so disturbing. Mm.
It is. That movie is really screwed up, which is why
we
enjoy it.
Yeah, I guess so.
I look at them like, hey, that's me in 10 years. No.
Yeah, there's a lot of movies I say that about.
You say that's Neil in 10 years? Or you,
No, about myself.
I got you. But yeah, that Maniac is just like very, there's like a dirtiness to the movie. It's just like, this is just a total sleazebag.
We joke around about the cover. It's clearly not the same guy. It's just some guy's pants.
Uh-huh. Right, right.
And he's just got this ginormous bulge in his crotch.
Yeah.
Next to the head of a woman, like around. It's just so suggestive and foul and vile
and awesome.
Perfect.
Yes, exactly.
And awesome. No, I noticed that. One of my friends actually has a few of those posters framed, and I was trying to get one of them off him the other day, but no, because that's just ridiculous.
Yeah, and he's got like, I think he even has his pants like a little unzipped and.
Well, like I was scarred at an early age. Like I went to a video store back when you still had to rent the VHS like players, you know?
Yeah.
Because they were like so new, and you had to like put like $100 down payment on it and stuff before you brought it back. the one movie I rented, I think I was 9 years old, Bloodsucking Freaks.
Oh my God!
And at nine, and the way that my house worked, like this was after church, we would go rent me a movie. My mom would take it back on her way to work on Monday morning or whatever. So we rented Bloodsucking Freaks, you know. And my mom goes in her room. She's like, I'm going to take a nap after church. And so I put in this movie. The first scene is a girl being dragged out of a crate by chains. And I'm like immediately like aware I cannot be watching this movie. If my mom sees me watching this movie, she's going to freak. And so I'm like darting back and forth between the TV and the hallway to make sure that she's not going to come down the hallway. And So at age nine, I was seeing a decapitated head giving a blowjob to a midget. So, you know, I was like kind of downhill from there.
Or uphill. Hello.
Yeah, right. Yeah, there you go.
Scooby-Doo's just not the same anymore.
Yeah. It was just kind of like, wow. What?
That's fine. I actually only saw that movie recently, a couple years ago, because it's one of Annabelle's favorites, and I'd never seen it.
Mm-hmm. And, wow.
No, I hadn't seen it. I was shocked. You have to watch this movie.
Oh, yeah. I mean, really, like, as an adult, I can appreciate it a lot more because it's like the, you know, Grand Guignol Theater or whatever, like, on, you know, their take on that and, you know, and just the midget guy. I can't remember his name. And just the whole Anton LaVey kind of, yeah, Ralphus, yeah. I don't know what to say about that movie. I haven't been like, I mean, I guess the first time I saw Happiness was about the same feeling I got. Like, yeah, this is wrong.
I've heard so much about
that movie. It's very wrong, but when you can, and this is not a self-promotion, really and truly, we have a video interview with Joel Reed, and there's an audio interview with Joel Reed. That guy, obviously, is weird, and he tells the best stories. I think it was Atlantic City.
Yeah.
Was it Atlantic City when he told, like, stories about all the parties and why people died and girls getting blowjobs at these parties? And he's so matter-of-fact and just deadpan when he's telling them. And sometimes he'll get a smile or whatever, but it's just mind-blowing. And then he'll talk about, like, some random actor in one of his, like, crap. I don't even remember the name. It was a real crappy, hard-to-watch movie. He was the Brad Pitt of his day. And Oliver Stone used to visit. And all these people that should remember him. And it's just, it's mind-blowing. He's an amazing storyteller. It's like one of those people you can't tell what's fact and fiction, but you're pretty sure it's fiction, but you never know.
Yes. Right, wow.
Joel Reed.
Yeah, so if you don't know, Joel Reed is the director of...
We've been told he hangs out in an underground bar, which sounds really scary.
Yeah.
I don't know if I want to go to this underground bar, but at the same time, I am curious.
Yeah.
Right.
And we're pretty sure during the podcast, he had, like, a woman, like, in a cage during the interview.
Yeah. Recently, he kept, like, kind of talking mumbled, and you could hear, like, a girl. It was very, and I don't think it would have been done for, like, an effect, like some kind
right,
of joke.
Right.
Background. This would have been like a legitimate. This guy has a girl in a cage.
Wow, that's kind of creepy.
That's me. Right, in 60
and that's
years.
Why we're gonna lose him.
Yeah,
there you go. Yeah. There you go. Well, I don't know. You may want to just go the full gamut and see what happens.
Brunch with Joel
Reed. You guys will report. We'll say, we're on our way to the bar with Joel Reed.
Yeah,
and
there you go.
And then people will know what happened, you know, where to look.
Yeah, right. That should be a live. That's got to be a live podcast. That's got to be. Just like, you got to do all that live.
That.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Secret Ustream. That's crazy.
You had mentioned Happiness is a movie I've heard so much about. I've never actually seen it, and a lot of people told me it'd be a movie I'd like. And kind of a friend of the show that Etan Mursky did the theme song for it, which I think is great.
The Happiness, Where Are You? I've Searched So Long for You.
Yes.
I love that song.
Yeah, I love that too. And someone else does it in the movie, but he has actually his own version that he sings. He wrote the song. He's, he has a version of him singing the song on YouTube, and it's fantastic. But yeah, I've not
you
seen
should,
the movie.
You should definitely watch that movie over the weekend. It's just it's very very strange on very many levels, and so uncomfortable. To just where first time I was watching it, I was just cringing. And granted, I saw it like the first time I saw it was right after it came out on VHS or whatever, and maybe I was a little less, you know, desensitized back then, because this was like before, you know, pre-internet, or, you know, right on the cusp of the internet, before I could afford the internet or whatever. And at that point I just, it was like, what the fuck? I suggest watching it. I think it's, and there's an amazing version of You Light Up My Life, sang by a Russian man. I love that song.
Yeah, I think actually Michael Stipe sings Happiness Song in the movie.
Oh, yeah?
I think so. I think that's what he said. I haven't seen it, but I remember him mentioning it on the video. Yeah. If you don't know Etan Mursky, I really enjoy his music, too. But have you ever seen American Splendor, the movie?
Yeah, oh, yeah. I love that movie. Yeah.
That's how I found out about Etan, which is kind of interesting, because I love that movie, and I love there's a song in there, American Splendor. Where's My American Splendor in a World of Cloudy and Gray? So I love that song, and so I found out that he was the guy who wrote it. And so I actually found him on MySpace back in the day and asked him if I could use the song. And just from there, I kept in touch with him, and we talk a lot. And he does a lot of music for different movies, and I really enjoyed it. It's, you know, offbeat stuff.
That's awesome.
It's good stuff. Yeah.
Now, that's what I inevitably want to do, is just write music for movies, not necessarily like that, but, you know, more along the lines of Goblin.
Yeah.
There's a part in American Splendor that, if you've seen it enough, I'm sure you'll remember, where he wakes up from a dream and he's like, oh, okay, I have a job. Thank God, you know, and I don't know if you remember that part where he like wakes up from a dream, and in his dream, I guess he was unemployed, and then he wakes up and realizes he still has a job, and he's like so comfortable and goes back to sleep. But now there's been parts of my life that have mimicked that, where it's like, I think my life's in hell, and it's like, oh no, I'm actually okay. It's like, go back to sleep. No, that part resonated with me for sure. But I love that movie.
Yeah, I do too. It's one of my favorites.
So what are some of your movies that have really that really mean a lot to you, and why?
Let's see. One is Death to Smoochie. Not just because Robin Williams just died, but that's just been a constant movie that I've watched like over and over and over. It's something about it reminds me of like watching Captain Kangaroo or H.R. Puffin stuff, or just those kind of shows like that. It's kind of like a behind the scenes of those shows or whatever.
I'm glad you brought that up before you go to your next one real quick, because I love Death to Smoochie, and it's always on like all these lists of the worst movies ever made. And I've always thought it was just an awesome film.
It's great.
Yeah.
I mean, I can't think of a bad thing about it, really.
Yeah.
The other one I would think is True Stories, the Talking Heads movie. That doesn't have a lot to do with the Talking Heads. That movie is Texas in the 80s. Like, it's just, it feels like just what Texas was like in the 80s. I don't know how better to describe it than that. I'm blanking on anything else to mention off the top of my head. I can't think of anything else that I've watched as much as those two movies. I know I watch a lot of movies over and over, but yeah, those are two that definitely stick out in my head.
Mm-hmm. It sounds like nostalgia is such a huge thing, and the things you enjoy and the things you like, all these different things, like talking about Death to Smoochie reminding you of stuff when you were a kid. Why do you think that so? Because some people just leave the past, pass in the past. They don't keep stuff. They just move. Why do you think that?
I'm very, very nostalgic. I mean, for example, I live in my grandparents' house that, like, my mom was raised here. My uncle was raised here. And I spent a lot of time here as a kid. And they've had the house since 54. And, every time I open a closet, I find some random old crap that, you know, that was around when I was a kid. And so aside from being surrounded by it, just in my physical, you know, being, I think that it's just, it's not that I'm searching for anything. It's that I've like, you know, I just really appreciate the way that things were more than the way they are now. And I don't think I'm trying to like capture that feeling, but at the same time, it's like, I would like to surround myself in as much of the past as possible because I don't really see a lot of, you know, things being long-term now. You know, I don't see, you know, that I'm going to be listening to Fancy the same way that I listen to, like, you know, some, I don't know, like something by the, like Never My Love by the Association. You know, I'm not going to be putting on Fancy by Iggy Azalea 20 years after the fact of hearing, you know, the song, like I do Never My Love by the Association or some, or like, you know, Superstar by the Carpenters, you know, that I grew up with. It's like things that seem to have more of a staying power, back in the past. And, I don't know. That's, something I've pondered myself, and other people have asked me that question before. And, I just think that it kind of is like, I like to remember where I came from, sort of thing, you know? And,
I was going to say, I'll take that movie idea the other way. What are some of your favorite childhood movies?
From when I was a kid? I would say, let's see, I guess my two favorite Disney movies would be Pete's Dragon and Bedknobs and Broomsticks. And, other than that, man, I really like, I don't know. I mean, I can't, it's like, I just used to watch a lot of TV when I was a kid. I don't think I even watched a lot of movies, but yeah, those would be my two favorite Disney movies.
Bedknobs and Broomsticks is awesome. That used to scare the hell out of me.
When what's that?
When they, all the, pieces of armor and whatnot come to life at the end, it used to freak me out.
Oh, yeah, and an interesting fact about that is the chant they do, the Triguna Macoides Jacorum Satis Dei, there's actually, like, literal, like, I think, like, satanic verbiage in there somewhere. So,
wow.
And, you know, the star, they're searching for the star of Astaroth. Astaroth was a demon, so, you know, that's kind of weird. And the whole thing's based on witchcraft, you know, so. So I don't know. It's kind of a
style. A lot of people wouldn't have known where things have changed so much, and you can be more open about that kind of interest than you would have been able to then. So no one would have ever picked up on that unless you really, really knew.
Oh yeah. Well, there was an internet like parental, you know, like tactic forces kind of things back then that were just like, we watch every movie and look for everything wrong with it, you know? So, I mean, it was pre-PMRC days or whatever.
I'm going to have to go back and watch this now. I don't remember this movie at all.
Great movie.
Great movie. Angela Lansbury, and it's a good movie.
Yeah. I like most of the old Disney movies when it's like real hand animation.
Right.
Yeah, and it's a blend. It's not, it's live action and cartoons. They have scenes where it's like all cartoons around them, and then there's scenes where it's kind of blended in the other way. It's very cool.
It's a lot of magic. It's on it, like, I mean, animation wise it's on par with like Mary Poppins or something like that, or Pete's Dragon, which also has a live animation, and like Pete's Dragon and I want to say Bedknobs and Broomsticks are both done by Don Bluth. Who did, like, you know, the Space Ace and Dragon Slayer and all that.
The old video games.
Secret of Nim.
I remember the old the arcade game for Dragon Slayer.
Oh, I love it. Yeah. No, I remember going into the arcade the first time and seeing that just, like, blew my head off. You know, I couldn't imagine, like, that we had gotten to that level of, you know, creativity in arcade games, because you go from Pac-Man to seeing Disney characters jumping around the screen, you know.
I wonder why they haven't, maybe they have, I don't know, I don't really play any video games, but done that more in a modern day where they would take like a well-known, artist and use their stuff for a video game.
they should. I think that video games should branch out a lot more than they do. I mean, if somebody put out a Twin Peaks video game, I'd be the first one in line to buy it. If somebody put out like, if somebody did a world-class championship wrestling video game, like, which I don't understand with WWE having the licenses to all of these companies, mm-hmm. why aren't they just doing a territory series where it's like you work your way through the territories and, you know,
cause they could still, because they could still put themselves over and say, oh, you got to get to the big time, get to the WWF.
Exactly. You see exactly where I'm going with it. But, you know, you have the thing where with your Xbox, it can, like, get information from the other video games, and it's like, you know, I mean, there's ways that they could make so much more money than they're making now, but they have to, you know, they don't like their fans, apparently, so.
Mm-hmm. That is weird. It's because I did a lot of wrestling conventions before I started doing the horror movie conventions, and once I started doing the horror movie conventions, it really kind of ruined the wrestling conventions for me, because no matter like how like well I know the wrestlers, how friendly I am with them off away from everybody else, they have this, they like look down on their own fans like they're marks. And there's like
right.
a varying degree. There's some exceptions, and this, you know, it's a degree of how they look down on people. But it's kind of universal that they look down on their own fans, and I don't see that at all. For the most part, in if it is, it would be the exception to the rule. In like the horror world, the actors, like, you know, they want to fit in with their fans. They don't even want to call them fans. And it's very strange. I don't think that's like a part of any other type of entertainment where they look so down on their own fans.
That's the kayfabe aspect, you know. And Annabelle, I'm sorry we keep going into wrestling here. I know this is a horror movie podcast, but you know, I do love the wrestling.
I think it's about people out there, and I know a lot of the people out there like it. So you guys do
it. but no, I mean. You know, the key word there is actors. When you go to the horror movie conventions, you're dealing with actors. When you go to wrestling conventions, you're dealing with wrestlers who don't consider themselves anything but wrestlers. They do not consider themselves actors. They don't consider what they're doing is fake because, you know, as you know and I know, that gravity, you know, wrestling may be fake, but gravity is not,
mm-hmm,
you know.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, an element of what they do is real, has been real, whatever, you know, but at the same time, they, they're definitely a different breed of character, you know, than like an actor, you know,
mm-hmm.
An actor, I feel like knows they're just like me. I'm a musician, you know, I don't have anything over my audience. You know, I'm not going to be a dick to anybody that says they like what I do. You know, that's, I'm just appreciative, you know, I don't feel like I'm keeping anything from, I don't feel like I have to, like, you know, keep a guard up or anything and make you think that I'm going to hurt you, you know, or anything like that.
Yeah, the whole idea of calling their fans marks, to me, it belittles what they do themselves, because if you think, wow, you're a fan of what I do, you must be a blithering moron. What does that
right.
say about what you do?
Exactly. It's kind of strange. I've never been to a wrestling convention, but I can only imagine, you know. I don't know. That's I know they're in a weird position just because they it's that whole keeping the business safe kind of thing. And a lot of those older guys, I think, are still in that mind frame.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know.
I will say the best response to that type of idea was we had Loverboy Dennis Condrey on the show, and it was brought up about what does he think when people say wrestling is fake, and he was like, "Yep, when I fall on the mat, I don't really hit the ground." It was very funny the way he put it, but basically, like you're saying about, you know, gravity's not real and he's not really hitting the ground, and it was
right.
it was clever, but yeah. But this is Zombie Month, so we do have to ask about. What's your favorite zombie film?
Definitely the original Dawn of the Dead. It may be because I've been watching it for so long.
Good man.
A close second would be Return of the Living Dead, just because that movie turned me onto the Cramps. It turned me onto TSOL. It turned me onto The Damned. Because, as soon as I saw that movie, I went out and bought the soundtrack on cassette at Camelot Music. And, I love the whole series, actually, the Night of the Living Dead, Dawn of the Dead, Day of the Dead.
You can stop there, though. You don't need to.
Yeah, exactly. I wanted to like Land of the Dead so much because I love Dennis Hopper in Texas Chainsaw Massacre Part 2.
Yeah.
It's one of my favorite performances ever. I mean, just him.
I don't think it's his favorite performance, though.
Well, screw him. He needs to watch it.
Film.
No, that movie, him singing Bringing in the Sheaves while brandishing two chainsaws, I don't know of a better scene in a movie, you know? So, Land of the Dead, I wanted to like it, and it was kind of weird. I went and saw it in the theater, and when I was in the theater in the very first part of the movie, somebody set popcorn on fire, so, they turned on the fire alarms and stopped the movie and stuff, and I thought it was, a gimmick, you know, like the shocker chairs or whatever from those old movies, but no, somebody just set popcorn on fire, No, I wanted to like that movie,
I know exactly what you mean. I've watched it many times, probably three or four times, wanting to like it, and I'm just like, this movie's just not good, so.
No, they went too far. They just, the whole Sky Flowers thing, and just, the zombie that's getting intelligent, and I don't know, man, you know.
Yeah, that idea, and then the very end of the movie, where they're just kind of we're going to let those zombies go and live their life.
Yeah.
And it's come on.
Yeah, what are you going to, live peacefully with zombies now? Yeah, right.
Because
give me Return of the Living Dead, where it's zombies strapped to a table talking, and they're zombies. They're not going to eat your brains, let them walk away.
Yeah.
So, I don't know.
There was I'll even say Day of the Dead. It took me a lot of viewings to like it. It was the one I wanted to like, and eventually I did kind of do like it. But Night of the Living Dead and Dawn of the Dead I love. Day of the Dead I kind of had to learn to like.
Dawn of the Dead, if I was in a zombie apocalypse back in the day, I would have run to a mall. Back when there were malls, and malls had things like food stores in them and things like that, and that mall looked like the perfect mall for them to be in. I kind of like the remake of Dawn of the Dead. As far as remakes go of those movies, it was way better than the Day of the Dead remake. But I do like the Tom Savini remake of Night of the Living Dead a lot, though.
I do too.
I don't know if have you seen that one?
Yeah, that actually made my list. We did last week. All three of us did a top 10 zombie list, and that made my list. I don't like it better than the original, but.
No.
I think the zombies themselves, it's the best movie for the look of zombies. For kind of the zombie gags.
No, I agree with that for sure. I really did like that one. I mean, after seeing the original Night of the Living Dead so many times, to see it end a different way to where Cooper gets killed, it's that's what you want to see, Dawn of the Dead by far.
Yeah. That's a great cast too, the remake of Night of the Living Dead. Bill Moseley's small part, you've got Tom Tolles as a Cooper, and,
right.
Candyman is the main guy. It's good stuff.
And Candyman's still a movie that freaks me out. I don't know why, but...
Tony Todd, there we go.
What's that? Yeah.
Tony Todd.
But, Candyman's a movie that definitely freaks me out for some reason. I don't know why.
I think it hits something that... when you're a kid, that kind of thing would scare the hell out of you. You get together with friends and you're going to say Bloody Mary in front of the mirror. If you've done those kinds of things, it does stick with you.
Yeah. And I've definitely done those kinds of things.
Yeah. I was just thinking, you know, with this conversation here, you talk, you know, a lot of, like Annabelle brought up, a lot of nostalgia means a lot to you. So I guess that does kind of tie in with how Candyman is disturbing to you.
Yeah, probably so.
So, do you have any upcoming projects or appearances?
Nothing of note, really. I think we're probably going to be touring. I don't know. We're trying to get up to Chicago and back to New York sometime in November. And so we're going to be kind of going up and to the east. But other than that, I mean, and nothing solidified yet. I mean, like I said, it's November, so it's quite a ways away. But no, I mean, we're just playing regionally right now for the most part. And we recently got dropped from Century Media, so we are now currently in search for a new record label. And which is, you know, neither here nor there. They were a strictly metal label, and we were definitely the, like, you know, redheaded stepchild of the family. Yeah. And so it's probably for the best on both parts. But now we were about three songs away from having a new album done, and we'll be shopping that around soon, and just that kind of stuff, you know, typical band stuff. And in the meantime, I'll be hanging curtains and artwork and, you know, hotel lobbies and shit like that. So,
how is it working under a label that is not you? Do they try to say, look, guys, you have to do blah, blah, blah?
No, not really, because I don't really. It was kind of a weird situation to begin with. We had put out our first album on this label called Handmade Birds, which is a locally run label, but he's done just a lot of incredible stuff. And when we did that, he marketed us in such a way to where we really took off more than we expected to. And so Century approached us, and when they did, I think they thought that it was just like, you know, an easy sell or whatever, but they didn't realize that the way that they market stuff is only through metal venues, and metal people do not take to us immediately. It's not something that metal people like a lot, and at least not just, they have to see it and absorb it for a bit, I think, before they can really get what we're doing. But so it was more a thing, I think they just kind of left us alone because they didn't know what to do with us in the first place, and they thought it was going to run itself. And then when they realized, like, no, that's not how this works, they were kind of like, we're going to go on without you. So that's okay. I'd prefer to work with somebody that knows that we're not a metal band, that we don't need to be marketed like a metal band. So
yeah. Considering that you were with Goblin touring with them, I think you probably will be fine.
Yeah. I'm not, you know, I did that. And honestly, that if that's all I said I ever had done, I'd probably be pretty okay with that, because I'm like one of a few people that can say something like that. But, you know, and this was only the second time Goblin had ever come to the U.S. So it may be the last time, because those guys are no spring chickens, you know. So I'm going to continue to keep doing what I'm doing and hope that it gets to the right ears and the right audiences. But, you know, it's just weird doing something that's like as heavy as it is, but it's still not metal, and people don't really know what to think of it. But at the same time, you know, whatever. I don't really care what people think of it. I'm just going to keep doing it. So,
What would a goal be for you as a performer?
The only other thing I can think of that I'd like to do, I want to end up doing soundtrack music. I know that John, the drummer, is in the same boat with that. You know, I mean, we just want to do soundtrack music. We're just looking for the next Dario Argento, you know, and I haven't found him yet. Aside from that, they're the French band Magma, that is our favorite band probably ever. If we could tour with them, that would be awesome. If we could tour with Magma and Goblin at the same time, that would be even better. If you haven't heard Magma, I suggest going to YouTube and looking up De Futura. and having your mind blown.
Pretty cool. What are some of your favorite venues you've performed in?
The Henry Fonda Theater in L.A. was spectacular. As far as where we normally perform, Lola's in Fort Worth is definitely the best venue that you can come to in Fort Worth. But I've played the Troubadour in L.A., and that was really awesome, just to be on the same stage that Karen Carpenter was on at one point, you know, and Van Halen. And I've played, it's not even so much the venues as much as the show itself, you know. And after a while, the venues just become venues, and it's just the show in particular, you know.
Yeah. And I did want to
add. You can play in an awesome venue, but they can have a crap sound system, and it won't make a difference. So. Mm.
What is your drink tonight?
Whiskey and Jim Beam and water. That is my drink of every night.
Okay. I prefer Jim Beam over Jack Daniels. I think Jack Daniels
too.
Is very overrated.
The Jack Daniels cask taste, like, there's too much wood flavor. Jim Beam is a much, like, it's got a tiny bit of sweetness, and I just like to dilute it with a splash of water, and yeah. I do about four of those a night, and then curl up on my couch.
I do think the bourbon taste actually comes through better if whiskey is diluted with a little bit of something.
Otherwise, you just have to sip it. You know, and literally have to sip it. I just can't. And I don't like sodas, any sodas or anything. I drink ginger ale if I have a stomach ache, but other than that, I don't like any of that. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it's just the whiskey and water.
Also, I'm a Wild Turkey man, but Jim Beam's
good. Ah, I'll drink that every once in a while.
Mm-hmm. I like the Wild Turkey. The Wild Turkey American Honey is actually my favorite.
Ah.
That might be too sweet for
you.
I'm
a big fan of vodka.
No, I used to drink vodka. I had a period in my life where I just drank screwdrivers and Jägermeister. And, that had to stop.
But I'm a good boy tonight.
No, I drink the old people drinks like vodka gimlets and salty dogs and greyhounds.
Oh, right.
I did start to drink, started to make old fashions when I started to watch Mad Men. That was a show I caught up on, kind of binge watching on Netflix, and he was always ordering an old fashioned. I was like, "What the hell is that?" So I'd look it up and how to make it. And it's a pretty good drink.
Did you used to do a series called Drinking with Jack?
Yes.
Okay, I remember those. Like, yeah, I remember watching a few of those. I watched several of the Grilling with Jack. Those are awesome.
Mm-hmm. I haven't done any for a while. I do want to bring them back and tie them in with Dinner and a Movie. So it'd be like.
There you go. You make dinner and then y'all watch a movie.
Yeah, or I make something and then I'll bring some along, and then Annabelle can you know, see if it's edible, or, you know, it's
cross promotion, right?
Yeah.
You gotta get you like a cooler, like one of those Domino's pizza heating things.
Exactly. Well, yeah. Or if
yeah,
if we just
last
had
an hour,
and we could get like a hibachi grill, I guess, and I could just grill it right there.
True. That's true.
Now the grilled angel food cake looked awesome, man. I just that's something I'd never even thought of.
Yeah, it was good. The drinking videos. There's one because one day I filmed like six of them in a row because I had all these recipes what I wanted to do. And I wasn't really thinking beforehand, so I'm filming them. And just like anything else, sometimes you got to take a couple takes because you know you mess up or something.
Right.
But it's not like fake alcohol. I'm really drinking the alcohol. And so, you know, it's like three or four takes, making this drink, three or four drinks. And then, like, I did six in a row. And I could tell when I watch them, I progressively get, like, loopier and loopier. But I don't know if you – I guess if you watch them out of order, it's not the same. But if you watch those particular episodes in order, it's – there was also – I forget what it was. There's some video I did, and I remember I drank a lot at the end of it, but then I filmed something and put it at the beginning, kind of like a dinner and a movie episode we did. And so the beginning,
right.
I'm like really slosh. I'm like totally out of it. But then it.
Most views. One where Neil is super shit faced in the very beginning has the most views of all of our videos.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Connection, myself.
Well, let me tell you something.
I think so. And our current one, the Jaws one, people are saying that was one of their favorites, and Annabelle was particularly wasted on that one.
No, I have to watch that.
I was having a good time.
Right, that's all I ever say.
I was just vomiting or jumping around or anything.
I was there. I was there. So of course you're having a good time.
But it was fun. I mean, paper hat. You know it's a winner when I make a paper hat.
I actually have the paper hat right here. So if someone would like that.
You destroyed my
hat. I recently had my first blackout on stage from drinking too much, and that was it was interesting. I was doing a solo thing. I have a country moniker that goes by the name of Dwayne Grubb, and he just does country like versions of 80s songs like Iran by Flock of Seagulls and Cure songs and stuff like that. And he drank about six shots of Jim Beam and made it home okay, thankfully.
Wow.
No, I don't remember what I played. I had to ask my girlfriend what songs I played. And yeah,
but
I played them. No, I still played. So and nobody acted like it was a bad show, so I was just like, I don't remember.
Well, I'm glad it went
well.
Sounds
like it all worked out to me.
Yeah. Right, yeah, I guess.
So all you kids out there, drink responsibly.
Exactly, yes, and let your girlfriend drive you home, or otherwise she'll be mad at you.
Exactly. Well, how would people find your music, by the way?
Easiest way is Bandcamp. You just type in Peakish Black. I think the first thing that comes up is Bandcamp. I post random solo stuff there from time to time, and you can find Peakish Black and Grey Tyrant music there. And, the Pointy Shoe stuff, I still haven't got that up for sale anywhere, just because there's, aside from that being a 2-piece band, that was a 6-piece band, at times a 7 or 8-piece band. And, I don't know that everybody would be fine with me, like, you know, selling that music or whatever. I mean, you know, I'll gladly give them the fucking 10 cents that I make off of it. It's their share or whatever. But that music, I think you can probably find it for download pretty easy. And all of that stuff's on YouTube. I mean, if you want to hear my music, just go type in Pinkish Black YouTube. If you want to see the American Idol audition, just type in Darren Beck on YouTube and you can see that. And if you want to see the Dragon Ball stuff, just type in Pointy Shoe Factory and you can hear that.
Very cool. And we've been playing it here all month. I'm a big fan of the music.
I love it. I would say that you are certainly in the top of my my musical choices that have been on the show.
Wow, that's a huge compliment. Thank you very much.
I love it. I love it. I really do.
Awesome. I'm really glad to hear that.
You're very welcome. I did notice you brought this up earlier. Some of your tracks are very long.
Yes.
And now, is that a personal taste or preference or what?
I think it's just ideas don't come out in 3.5 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes it takes a while for an idea to develop. And I don't know that you can necessarily lose yourself in music like in 3.5 minutes, you know. I feel like
you
it's better
being able to write like a pop song recently. It's not like you're doing this catchy chorus kind of you're going to sing it in your car to yourself. This is stuff you sit with, and like you're saying about you playing it, you sit with it, you invest yourself, you're just there with it.
Mm-hmm.
You're not fucking to walk down the street and whistle to it.
I guess it depends, you know, but
Britney Spears, I guess.
No, definitely not. Thank fucking God. But because, yeah, I think I would hate to say, but I probably am more relevant than her right now. But that's not saying a lot. But, you know, I don't know. It's just I feel like what I'm doing is just soundtrack kind of music. And, you know, it's like you're not really supposed to, like, it's never anything that's supposed to end up on radio. It's never supposed to be, you know, just some little catchy ditty, you know, that is disposable. You know, this is something you're actually supposed to get into. So, you know, it's like, I mean, I guess, you know, you can harken back to Pink Floyd or whatever. You know, it's not the music that, like, is supposed to be, you know, selling Coca-Cola. You know, it's, this is music for people that actually like music, you know?
Yeah.
And a lot of people don't. A lot of people will say they listen to a lot of music, but they don't actually like music. They just listen to it, you know? And, you know, so this is for a music listener, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Music for people who like music.
There you go.
Mm-hmm. Well, we want to thank you for coming on tonight.
Man, thank you for having me. I've been a big fan of both of y'all for a long time, and it's an honor and a pleasure. What can I say?
I brought this up along those lines. I listened to your music because you'd posted on thing on the Facebook page, and you'd brought up that you listened to our podcast, you know, while you're traveling. And I listened to music, and I thought I loved it too. And it's very cool that you know, through the internet, we could share each other's our own things that we do and enjoy it. So it's very cool.
Absolutely. I mean, if the internet has a positive thing to do, you know, that's what it's doing. It's connecting people that actually, like, can give a shit about what the other person's doing. So, you know, that's it's good to have that kind of connection with people. So, like I said, it's an honor and pleasure.
Mm-hmm. Annabelle and I wouldn't know each other otherwise, and that's a big part of Without Your Head is the community aspect.
Well, that's awesome, too.
Yeah, I'd still be miserable. Well, I am miserable, but I'd still be extra miserable grumbling to myself.
Exactly. All right. Well, we will talk to you again soon. It really has been a lot of fun talking to you.
Yeah, it's been a real pleasure, and I really am truly happy that you ended up connecting with us, because I do really, really enjoy your music.
Well, thank you very much. I really appreciate that.
Mm-hmm. And the fact that you are a fan of us really does put you up in my books.
Well, I appreciate that too, Neil.
Exactly. Just keeping it real. All right.
Hi, this is Michael Graves, and you're listening to WithoutYourHead.com.